We just ask God that you would lead and direct, Father, this study in the Gospel of John, Lord, that you'd touch our heart, that you'd cause us, Lord, to just keep our eyes set upon you, Father, in a way that's significant, that's meaningful, Lord, as we abide in the vine, Father. So we ask that you would just illuminate some truths that would help us get through this week, that would give us a word of encouragement, Father, that show us an area that we need to realize in our lives and allow you to change it. In Jesus' name, amen. Please open your Bible to the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, chapter 15. Chapter 15, and we're going to be picking it up in verse 16. We know in chapter 15 and in chapter 16 that Jesus and his disciples, his 11 disciples, have left the upper room, has left that, and they are now heading over to the Garden of Gethsemane. We're in the final hours of Jesus' life, literally the final hours. He's already had Passover. They've already broken the bread. They have now left it. They've walked down. He passed some vines and some vineyards, and he talked about him being the vine. And he's just a few hours away, and you stop and you think, if you just had a couple hours to live, and you had the loved ones around you, what would you say to them? Think about that. What would be your final words, the significant words that you would share with those people that you love? And so we're going to pick it up here in verse 16, and we're going to continue on through in the chapter 16. It says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain. That whatever you ask the Father in my name, whatever you ask in my name, he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another." See, chapter 15, as we've been reading about, has been all about abiding in the vine and allowing the Lord, right, to produce the fruit of the Spirit, his love, his unconditional love in our lives. Because the only way we can produce love, guys, is by abiding in Christ. We can't muster it up. We can't fake it. We can't do it. We need to stay plugged into the vine. We need to stay plugged into Jesus Christ. We need to allow the bread of life to fill our lives, the Spirit of God to fill our lives, to get all our source, all our strength, everything we need from the vine. Because if we do, guys, then we can have that unconditional love that Jesus had, that servant love he had to wash his disciples' feet. But you can't have that servant-like love without abiding in Christ. That love where you're going to honor someone who's going to betray you like he did when he took the matzah bread and he dipped it in the bitter herbs, which could have been the horseradish, and he gave it in honoring Judas Iscariot right before he's going out to deceive him and to betray him. We can't love our enemies that way, right, without the Lord. We can't. We don't have that ability within ourselves. He says, "Greater love has no man unless he lays down his life for another," as we read about. We can't have that kind of love. You know, we're so selfish people. But as we abide in the vine, he made it clear it was possible only by doing that. And now here in verse 16 of chapter 15, he says an incredible thing. He says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." See, normally when we want to learn under somebody, we get to choose the teacher we want to learn under. You know, and disciples would pick the rabbi they want to learn under. You know, you send your kids to a certain college, you send them to a certain place, because you want them to learn under a certain course of study or under a certain person. But here we see that Jesus, the rabbi, does something different. Jesus, the rabbi, picked and chose his disciples that he wanted to teach. "You did not choose me, but I chose you." You know how great that is? That we're chosen by Jesus? I mean, he chose us that we might abide and have a relationship with the eternal God. He chose us that just as the branches were on the ground, he would lift us up, right? He would prune us. He would wash us. He chose us that we might call him our friend. He chose us, as we read in chapter 15, that whatever we ask in his name, he would answer our prayers. And everything that he had from the Father, he called us friends and he made known to us. That's the relationship, because he loves you and he cares about you and he chose you. Circuits break and blow in my mind they just pop when I think of the eternal God who created everything would look at me and choose me. I know me. You know you. You're just as astonished. But that's how much God loves us and cares for each one of us. All these privileges we have in Christ is all based on the fact and rooted in this statement here that he chose us. And you might stop. And you look at these 11, his disciples, and they're kind of a group of misfits. I mean, they wanted to be known who was going to be the greatest in God's kingdom, right? Thomas has a nickname. What's his name? Doubting Thomas. We know that. I mean, you know, this guy lacks faith. Two of them are called the sons of thunder. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm here. I'm in the room. What do you want to do? Let's bring down fire. That's who he chose. He chose these. Peter, in a couple hours, is going to go cut off the servant's ear of the high priest. And Jesus is going to go, Peter, come here. What am I going to do with you? These are the people that he chooses. They're flawed people. And you go, well, yeah, but hey, read the Bible. Everyone's flawed. Abraham, the father of faith, doubted that God would take care of him and went to Egypt. He told his wife to lie. That's our father Abraham. Isaac did the same thing. He showed favoritism towards Esau, right? He was already, you know, you don't want to show favoritism, one child over the other. And he also told his wife, because he feared his life, to lie. Jacob, the heel catcher, the conniver like his mom, steals Esau's birthright. King David was a murderer and adulterer. Solomon did the very thing that God told him not to do. He acquired horses. He had many wives that caused his heart to be pulled. Just go through the Word of God. Go through the Old Testament. They're all flawed people. One of my favorite flawed person is Gideon. Gideon, we're going to do the study, guys. When we do the men's retreat, we're going to do it on Gideon. I love Gideon. Gideon was a guy that during the time the Amalekites were all hanging around, and they were all around the area. There were so many, they were like the sand. They were just everywhere, locust covering these Amalekites and these Midianites. And here was Gideon, and Gideon was threshing wheat. He was threshing wheat in a wine press. A wine press presses grapes and it flows downhill, normally inside. We're going to see a wine press when we go to Nazareth. When you thresh wheat, you do it normally at the high point. So when you thresh it, all the stuff, what? Flies away and the wheat falls down. He was hiding. He was hiding from the Midianites. And when he was hiding from the Midianites, that's when the angel of the Lord said, "Hello, mighty man of valor." Mighty man of valor, the guy was a chicken. He was scared. But God saw in him things that God sees in us. The very same thing he sees in his disciples. He looks beyond the person. He doesn't see our ability, but our availability, our willingness to be used for his purposes. And I like that. And the story just continues. It continues. And I got 32,000 men against a multitude. That's a good point. That's too many. What? Tell those people that want to go home to go home. If you want to go home, leave the army. 22,000 leave. Now he's down to 10,000. Good idea, God. Still too many. What? Too many. Tell them to drink out of the water. So they start drinking out of the water. Some drinking this way. Some putting their face down. And God says, okay, those people that were drinking like this, and some people says, because they're looking the way they're supposed to be looking for the enemy, we'll just take those people. It's down to 300 now. 300. Now, my own personal perception is the 300 people that he chose were people like me. They were old, and they can't walk. They were people that were like real strong, right? Because God was going to do an impossible thing through impossible people. It wasn't the strong. It wasn't those that were capable. I think it was people that were just, again, more misfits. But people that were willing to stay. People that were willing to be there with the Lord. And then he gets his plan. So what's the plan, God? Okay. We're going to break up into three groups. Great. I'm going to go from 300 to 100. We're going to give you a trumpet. We're going to give you a clay vessel. And we're going to give you a torch. We're going to light the torch. You're going to put the torch underneath, and you're going to go over to this side, and you're going to go over to this side, and you're going to, okay. And when I say I want you to shout, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon, and then I want you to blow your horn, and then break the jar, crack open the clay thing, and let the fire go. And then what's going to happen? They're just going to kill themselves. Friendly fire. Just watch. I'm going to get the victory. You see, when God uses broken clay vessels like you and I that are willing to let his light shine, then people are going to go, wow. It's not the clay vessel that's going to get the glory. Who's going to get the glory? It's going to always be God. And that's how he does it. He uses a bunch of crackpots. And that's what we are. We're just hopefully nothing but a broken vessel to be used for the Lord. I like how it says in 2 Corinthians 4:7. But we have this treasure in what? Earthen vessels. You got that, don't you? It's an earthen, it's a clay pot. We have the treasure that God has given to us in our lives. Why? That the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. You catch that? God's going to use us so that he gets the glory, so that no glory will ever come to us. And he chose these people, and he appointed his disciples that were going to be used, even though they were flawed. And guys, God is still using broken vessels, a bunch of crackpots, a bunch of people just willing to be used for the Lord. Because when God uses me and he uses you, you know, people are going to go, well, I know it's not them. It's got to be the Lord. And as we realize that, we go, oh, then it's not based upon me? Yeah, so I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me? You're getting there. You're getting there. You're getting to the point that it's not you. And these disciples were just told by Jesus as they're walking over a few hours, and he's making this point, I have chosen you. I have appointed you that you would bear fruit, that the love of God would just come forth in your life, and that that fruit would remain. And I just love that. Not fake fruit, not stuff that we try to muster up in our strength and then get exhausted, but truly being able to love this person who there's nothing in me to love him, but God's love works through in my life. And that's what happens, guys, when that happens, that we can love people as I have loved you, as Jesus said. So he's now walking, and he's leaving the upper room. He's going through the Kidron Valley. He's going to the Garden of Gethsemane. And it says, and you got to realize, where's Lazarus? He's gone, right? Not Lazarus. Where's Judas? Judas is gone, right? He's gone. He's getting ready to betray Jesus. You need to realize that back in John 11, after Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, from that point on, they were plotting to kill Jesus. It says in chapter 11, verse 47, then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council and said, what shall we do? For this man works many signs. They just saw Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. And it says in verse 53, and from that day on, they plotted to put him to death. And you got to realize Judas Iscariot, he left the Last Supper, the Passover Seder that we just talked about, and now he is betraying Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. See, Jesus is soon going to experience hatred and persecution from the world that would ultimately result in his death. And he wanted his disciples now, as they're walking over, to realize that if this is going to happen, this hatred and this persecution is going to happen to Jesus Christ, their master, do not think that you will be exempt from the exact same hatred and persecution from the world. And we need to realize that too, guys. Do not think that we're going to be exempt from the world's hatred and persecution. So let's go read verses 18 through 25 here. We'll read the whole thing and we'll come back to it. It says, if the world hates you, he's telling his disciples this, if the world hates you, know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, you know what would happen? The world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. But all these things they will do to you for my name's sake, because they do not know him who sent me. That's why they're going to do it. Verse 22. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would have no sin, but now they have no excuse for their sin. He who hates me hates my Father also. If I have not done among them the works which no one else did, they would have no sin. But now they have seen and they hated both me and my Father. But this happened that the word might be fulfilled, which was written in their law, they hated me without a cause. He's telling his disciples that they're going to experience some things in the world of hatred and persecution. It says, verse 18, pick it up there. If the world hates you, you know that they hated me before it hates you. Now, here's something you may not realize, because we live in this world that we think that everyone loves Jesus. The world hates Jesus. The world hates the name of Jesus. Jesus Christ is the only religious cuss word that I know of in this world. Think about that. Nobody says, oh, Buddha. Oh, Joseph Smith. Oh, Shiva. Oh, Allah. When they get mad, they don't do that. Think about that. They hate Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the only cuss word that is used in this world. Those of us that have chosen to respond and yield our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ, to abide fruit, to connect with him, we are known by our what? Love. But the world is known by its hatred. So that's what it says. Just as the disciples are known by their love, the world's going to be known by its hatred, the hatred of those that love Jesus Christ. And he's telling his disciples, and these guys are walking on down, expect to be rejected. Isn't it amazing sometimes in this world when we just stand up for truth and we just share truth and people don't receive what we say, we're kind of astounded. We just can't believe it. It's so obvious to us. It's so clear to us. It's kind of like when David last week was talking about the Passover. And he's just amazed because Jesus is all over every aspect of the Passover, right? You see it. And yet his parents he was talking about, it's just what? Just over their head. They're just blind to the elements of Christ throughout it. That's the same way. You see, Jesus is going to be targeted, he's going to be falsely accused, he's going to be whipped, he's going to be beaten, he's going to be mocked, and he's going to be crucified. And if they did it to his master, rest assured, it's going to happen to us also. And we know what? That's exactly what happens with the disciples. He knew what was coming, and he was preparing his disciples for what was going to happen. Why? It says in verse 18, I'm just going to recap, the world's going to hate you because it hates me. Why does the world hate Jesus? Verse 19, because you are not of the world, therefore the world hates you. Because you're not of the world. We are moving to a whole nother destination. We are passing on through. Verse 20, remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than the master. If they persecuted me, they're going to what? Persecute you also. You could bank on that. Why? 21, but all these things they will do to you because you align with Jesus. For my name's sake, just because you align with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, guys, if we embrace the values of the world, if we embrace a philosophy, the ideology of the world, you know what? The world would love us. Verse 19 says, if you were of the world, what? The world would love its own. You know, all we've got to do is just play this gray area. Just see all roads lead to heaven. Just hold hands and sing kumbaya with everyone of every faith. And the world will go, oh, you're so loving. You're so caring. But that's not what we do. And why are they going to be doing this? Verse 21 said, because they do not know him who sent me. Verse 23 says, he who hates me hates the Father also. Verse 25 said, and they hated me. Why? Without a cause. For no reason, for no purpose. And soon the disciples that are walking with Jesus down the Kidron Valley, heading over the Garden of Gethsemane, are going to know the hatred of the world. All of them are going to die except for John as a martyr. And Christians throughout the century have known the hatred of the world. And millions have died for Jesus. And you might say, well, Brad, that's great. But that's a thing of the past. Wake up. Wake up. More Christians have died in the 20th century and now into the 21st than any period of time in history. I want you to listen to this. This is huge. More have died. Today in the 21st century, the time that we're living, there is persecution like we've never have experienced in modern history. Here's a video I want you to see. This is talking about the top five countries and is put out by Open Doors. A couple minute video. Go ahead.
Imagine being arrested because you own a Bible, or finding that the government has suddenly closed down your church. Imagine being denied education or employment because you're a Christian, or being thrown into prison just because you told someone about Jesus. Imagine being forced out of your home because of your faith, or living in a country where there's absolutely no freedom of belief. Hard to imagine, isn't it? Yet this is the cost of faith for millions of Christians around the world. Every day, they pay this price with courage and hope. And these are the top five countries where their faith costs the most. Number 5, Pakistan. In Pakistan, an estimated 700 Christian women and girls are abducted every year. Any Christian can find themselves accused of blasphemy and end up in jail or attacked by an angry mob. But even though churches have been bombed and attacked, Pakistani Christians continue to meet together and shine God's light. Number 4, Libya. In the lawless state of Libya, militant Islamists attack Christians with impunity. Desperate Christian migrants have been killed or sold into slavery. Yet despite the danger, Libyans are still coming to Christ. Number 3, Somalia. In Somalia, just being suspected of being a Christian can lead to instant execution. But brave Christians still gather in small groups, constantly changing the location of their meetings to avoid detection. Number 2, Afghanistan. There are only a few thousand Christians in Afghanistan, and they keep their faith hidden. Anyone known to follow Jesus can face violence from their family or tribe. But even here, people encounter Christ through radio programs or, miraculously, in dreams. Number 1, North Korea. North Korea is number 1 for the 18th consecutive year. In this land, the leaders are worshipped as gods. Christians are viewed as enemies of the state. Some 50,000 to 70,000 Christians are imprisoned in labor camps.
That's pretty amazing, huh? Isn't that something? According to Open Doors, this is 2019. This is today's statistics. 11 Christians are killed every day for their decisions to follow Jesus. Today. 11 Christians are killed every single day. 245 million Christians face persecution every day. And that's major persecution from their family, from their communities, from the state. Right now, today as we're speaking, 1 in 9 Christians worldwide face persecution throughout the whole world. Now, we live in a place where our persecution is people just don't like what we say, or they might diss us, or they have nothing to do with us. And you know what I mean? We're talking major persecution today. Pray for our fellow believers. Amen? There's one church, guys. There's one church. And those that believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, always remember that. You know, last Sunday, I don't know if you're aware of this, I think most of us are, when we were meeting here on Resurrection Day, and we were celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Muslim jihadist terrorist group targeted Christian churches a week ago, leaving more than 320 Christians dead and more than 500 injured on a South Asian island of Sri Lanka. That was 1 week ago. I think the thing that frustrated me more was some of the responses of our leaders. Obama said the attack on tourists and Easter worshipers. They called Christians Easter worshipers in Sri Lanka are an attack on humanity. 3 hours later, Hillary Clinton tweeted, "I'm praying for everyone affected by today's horrific attack on Easter worshipers." We don't worship Easter, Estar, the pagan. We don't worship that. We worship the resurrection of Jesus. We praise God for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And yet they won't say Islamic Muslims, and they won't say Christians. We live on such being politically correct, this PC world that we live in, it's hard not to get so frustrated with that and where we are. Yet we live in a country where we're able to celebrate the faith that we have quite openly right now. And it is a praise God. In verse 18, it says, "You know it hated me before it hated you." And you got to realize that the persecution that's going to come upon the disciples is first going to be directed towards their rabbi, to their master, to their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so just know that when the attack comes to you and people reject you for standing up for the truth, for being aligned with Jesus Christ, you're in good company. Always realize that every single time. If I was to go, it says in verse 19, "If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you." As I said, if I was to say all roads lead to heaven, people would say that's great. All you got to do is just be a good person and you'll get to heaven, and people will say that's great. But if I go and share God's truth, that Jesus said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and no man comes to the Father except through me." It has to, because he is the way. He provided the way by the death on the cross. And you look at that, people will say, "You're so close-minded. You're so unloving. Yet I just shared the truth with you." They don't want to hear the truth. Paul, in writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:10 said, "But you have carefully followed my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance." Now listen to this next list. "Timothy, you followed my persecutions. You followed my afflictions." You see that? "Which happened to me in Antioch and Iconium and Lystra, what persecutions I endured. And out of them all, the Lord delivered me." Now here's your Bible verse to memorize, guys. Verse 12. "Yes. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus," what? "Will suffer persecution." That's a promise of God. That's a promise of God. That's a promise that as we desire to live godly in Christ Jesus, we're going to be rejected, we're going to be pushed aside, we're going to be hated. So when that happens, as he's telling his disciples, just know that if they did it to me, they're going to what? Do it to you. So be encouraged. Be encouraged. As we stand for the truth of God's word and do not choose to support the views and the values of the world, how come? Because he's chosen us to not be of the world. He's chosen us out of the world. We're going to be shunned. And many of them have been shunned by our community and by our families. In verse 21, he says, "But all these things you will do to you for my name's sake, because they do not know him who sent me." Matthew 5:10 says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of God." We're going to suffer persecution, and we're blessed for it. And verse 11 says, "Blessed are you if you revile and be persecuted you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake." Now, you hear what it says? For my name's sake. Because we represent Jesus Christ. If the persecution is coming to you because you're acting like a jerk, you got it? Or you're being obnoxious and you're saying, "Look what I'm doing, it's because of Jesus." No, it's because you're acting weird. But if you follow the Lord and you keep your eyes and you get persecuted, does that make sense? Because you're being a Christian, you're being a light, then rejoice in that. I got to be careful and make sure that I'm not pushing people away because of my self-righteousness. That I'm not pushing people away because I'm haughty. I'm not pushing people away here because of me. I just want to be that broken vessel and be a light for Jesus. And don't worry, they will reject you. That's a promise you can have. I like how Peter said it, "But let none of you suffer," if you're going to suffer persecution, "let none of you suffer as a murderer, as a thief, as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters." Oh, they don't like me. Why? Because I'm just passing around gossip and I'm getting all this persecution. You're being a busybody. You're getting persecuted because you're being a sinner. You're acting obnoxious. Stop it. Don't do that. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. I love it. Matthew 5:12 then continues and said, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." You see, I love that. We're in good company, guys. And they did it because they don't know who sent them. I like how he's doing this. In the midst of what's coming to him, he's given his disciples this word of encouragement to his departing friends. And that he says, stay in me, stay plugged in me. But he also said in chapter 14 that we're going to be leaving. I'm not going to leave you by yourself. It says in verse 26, but when the Helper comes, who I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. We've talked about this before in verse 14, 16, and 17 says, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. We talked about this before. Right now with Jesus, the discipling process is to hang with Jesus, right? To be with him. But he can only be one place at one time. And Jesus is saying, guys, I'm going to send you someone to help you. The Paracletus, the Comforer, the one who's going to come alongside each one of us. Isn't that great to know? I love having a helper. I love how I took off this top of this chimney on top of my house that has some dry rot. Had to put some new shingles on there. And Bill said, you want some help? I said, 5.5 hours we were done. That would have been over 3 days by myself. You know what I mean? When you got a helper, it's like, you know, it's like one third the time. When it's Bill, it's like one tenth the time. You know what I mean? I'm getting old, guys. I'm not as fast as I used to be. And so it's one of those degrees. It's great to have a helper, and that's exactly what's going to happen. See, Jesus is going to continue to be with the church and train the church and grow the church and disciple the church, but he's not going to be there himself. He's going to send a helper who's what? The Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's going to now be in each one of us every single time. It says he will dwell with you and he's going to be in you. He's not going to leave us orphans. He's not going to leave us all by ourselves. He's going to work for us and in us and through us through the power of the Spirit. And guys, we're going to read as we're going to continue the book of Acts. The church will not skip a beat. It's going to continue to move on through with the Holy Spirit in their lives. I love it. It says, when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you, the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father. Make note of this. It's so important to understand. The purpose of the Holy Spirit, it says, he will testify of me. This is very important. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is to bear witness, to point to Jesus Christ, to testify to Jesus Christ, to take the spotlight. Don't point it to the Holy Spirit, but point it to who? To Jesus. Every single time. That's the main ministry of the Holy Spirit. So let me put it this way. The job of the Holy Spirit is not to attract attention to himself, but to rather to focus the spotlight on Jesus Christ. Jesus is the star, not the Holy Spirit. A church that is preoccupied by the Holy Spirit, always focusing on the gifts of the Holy Spirit to the exclusion of Jesus Christ, ready, is a church that is not being led by the Spirit. Does that make sense? If there's this constant preoccupation upon the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and not on Lord Jesus Christ, it's proof that it's not being led by the Spirit, because the purpose of the Spirit is to point to who? Jesus Christ, to witness to Jesus Christ, to testify to Jesus Christ. When I see a church and they're so wrapped up on the things of the Spirit, they forget about Jesus. They're worried about all the experiences of the Spirit, but not worrying about the Lordship of Jesus Christ in their life. They're missing it. They're missing it. They're majoring in the minors and their minories in the majors. See, everything the Holy Spirit does will always be consistent with the nature of Jesus. His job is to tell us and to show us who Jesus is every single time. And if I see things that are not consistent with the nature of Jesus, then I know it's not being led by the Holy Spirit. I want you to get that. When you see things and people do things, but it's not in the nature of Jesus, it's not being led by the Holy Spirit. A church that is truly Spirit-led will be a church who is all about and is focused on Jesus Christ. Because he said, when the Helper comes, he will testify of me. And it says in verse 27, and you will also bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. See, empowered by the Helper now, even though persecution is going to come, even though trials are going to come, empowered by the Helper, by the Comforter, by the Paracletus who's coming alongside me, who's filling my life, you know what? I can now share the good news to a lost and dying world, and I can be a witness of Jesus Christ. See, they've been with Jesus Christ. They walked with the Lord Jesus Christ. And now they're going to be continuing through the power of the Spirit. And it says in verse 1 of chapter 16, these things I have spoken to you, that you should not be made to stumble. They're going to put you out of synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think that he offers God's service. Pretty amazing. They already saw one person kicked out of the synagogue. And now he's saying, you guys are going to be kicked out of your own home church. You're going to be excommunicated from your own home church. In fact, there's going to be a time that's coming that when people will actually kill you thinking they're serving God. But he's saying these things that you should not stumble. And we know there was a time when there was a Pharisee. His name was Saul. He was a zealous Pharisee. And he was actually at the place where they had the first martyr, who was Stephen. And he was holding the coats of all those who were picking up the stones and killing him. That was Saul. And it says in Acts 8:1, now Saul was consenting to his death, that's Stephen's death. At that time, a great persecution arose against the church, which was in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. You see, Saul, who later became who? Paul, he was a zealous religious Jew. He said in Philippians, talking about his self-righteousness as a religious Pharisee, he said, concerning zeal, you know what I did? I persecuted the church. He thought he was serving God, but he wasn't serving God. And see, many times most of the Christian martyrs were targeted by other religious groups. That's what happens. They think they're doing God. Think about what happened last Sunday at Sri Lanka. All those people were killed. And they think that they're killing unbelievers because they want to be blessed by Allah, because they want to go to this paradise. They think they're serving God, yet they're coming against them. And that's what's happening today. And it says in verse 3, and these things they will do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. That's exactly what he said, verse 21. But these things I have told you, verse 4, that when the time comes, you may remember that I told you them, and these things I did not say to you at the beginning because I was with you. I'm telling you these things so that you don't forget it. I'm telling you these things of persecution and the power of the Holy Spirit in your lives so you don't forget it. When I was 25, after teaching 3 years as a science teacher in Biggs, I really felt the Lord wanted me to get my administrative credential. And so I started working on my master's and going back to Chico State. And I had a guy come up to me, and he said, you know, Brad, you got to realize something. It's going to be very lonely there. You know, when you're the boss, that's lonely, you know. And you got to realize that it's not a hat that you can take off and put on. It's a head. You can't remove it. You're going to be the head. And it's just, that's, you know. And people are going to look at you totally different the moment you cross over. And I thought, no, they're going to know Brad. I'm still Brad. I'm still weird old Brad. I got my administrative credential. I became vice principal, went across the valley to another school. Day 2, day 3, science teacher walks into my office. Now, I was just the science teacher at Biggs. He said, hi, I'm so-and-so. I go, you teach physics, huh? He says, yeah. I said, Yesterday I was a science teacher. Today I'm here. He says, we don't like you. We don't like administration. Well, hello to you too. Get to know me, then you won't like me. For you know what I mean? But don't say don't like me, you don't even know me. When you know me, you won't like me, but that's okay. But I thought, wow, overnight, and here's my point. I didn't get hurt. I didn't get pushed out of shape. You know why? Somebody preloaded me. Somebody said, hey, here's a little word of advice. Don't be shaken when this happens, because it's going to happen. And even though you haven't changed, people's perception is going to change. And that's what he's telling his disciples. People are not going to like you, and don't be shaken by it. Don't be moved by it. Don't be. When the time's going to come, I want you to think back and remember all these things that I told you. Don't take it personal. Because if you do, you're going to get bummed out. And that's what Jesus is telling us this morning. That as we stand for him, and we stand for the truth, and we stand and be that light, that we're going to be persecuted, that we're going to be misunderstood. Pray we don't do it because we're a bad witness. Pray that we're doing it because we are letting the light so shine. Pray that we're doing it that we are a broken vessel that his light comes through. Pray that that occurs because we are tapped in the vine and we are allowing the Lord Jesus to flow through our lives. But here's the good news. He's not abandoning us. He's not leaving us orphans. We got the power of God living in each one of our lives. And we need to keep our eyes on the Lord, guys. Because when you get our eyes off the Lord and we start doing it in the power of our own strength, it's impossible. But with Christ, we can do what? All things we can. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your word, Lord. God, that you love us so much. Jesus, thank you for this dialogue you had with your disciples and telling them these important things, God. Thank you, Lord, that you chose each one of us. I pray if somebody's never asked Jesus Christ, how do I know if I'm chosen? Just say, Lord Jesus, I want you in my life, and you will realize you've been chosen. If there's anyone here that would like to say, Lord Jesus, come into my life. I need you as my Lord and Savior. Look up and put up your hand. Is there anyone here this morning? If you're watching this online, just say, Lord Jesus, I believe you. I receive you into my life. And you realize you have been chosen by God and appointed to do his works, to bear his fruit. I really think a lot of people here are going through a lot. A lot's happening. A lot of frustration, maybe some persecution, maybe just some difficulties in their lives. And they want prayer from their body. We haven't prayed the last couple of weeks. And they want prayer to hold up their hands, pray to help them through some things they're going through. If that's you, look up this morning. Is there anyone we want to pray for? Thank you, brother over here. Thank you, sis. Thank you. Thank you in the back. Thank you guys in the booth. Got you. Thank you in the back row there. Yes. Thank you, brother. Thank you, sis. Thank you here. Thank you up front here. Thank you over here. Thank you, guys. Right here, sis, way in the back. Thanks. Way, way back there. In the middle there. Got you both. Father, let's pray for each other, Lord. We all have needs, Father. We all live in this world. We have trials. We have difficulties, God. Lord, let us realize that we just need your power and your strength. Father, we've come to the end of ourselves. We've tried to do it in our own strength and our own power. And Lord, let us quickly realize we don't have that strength and power. We weren't created to do it by ourselves. Lord Jesus, fill our lives. Give us a fresh feeling of your Holy Spirit, God. Do that work. Give us that love for that person that's driving us crazy. Give us the strength to endure the hardship, Father. And I just ask, God, for great wisdom. For those people that are asking for direction right now, give them wisdom. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a wonderful rest of the day. Quilting.